we all had our conversation in times past, in the lusts of the flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But God, who is rich in mercy and for his grace, loved wherewith he loved us. Even when we were dead in our sins, hath he quickened us together with Christ. By grace we are saved, and hath raised us together and made us together and set us together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he may show his exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness towards us through Christ Jesus. For by grace ye are saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, or created in Christ Jesus, unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk therein.
For by grace you are saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God. Hiding in the back, behind a yard sale table, the chair is scratched and battered. Its finish is dull. Its seat is broken. It is unlovely and unusable. But you buy it. You take it home, recane the seat, and restore it to its original beauty. Now it is a treasure, noticed by every guest, used at every dinner, because you paid the price of time and hard work. This process plays out if you restore an antique car or a Victorian home. You take something that seemed worthless to some people and transform it. This is exactly what God did for each one of us. Trapped in our transgressions, we lived in a world where life is cheap and self-interest is king. God purchased the ugly, useless hulk of our lives with the blood of Christ. Then, by his grace, he changed us into something beautiful and desirable. Just like an old piece of furniture, we did nothing to make the change possible. Our new beauty is God's gift. We are God's workmanship, and now, because of the wonderful being he has made of us, we can spend our days letting him use us as he wills.
Now I belong to Jesus, hymn 637. This is one of my favorites, so I'm going to ask you to rise. Let's sing this together.
Jesus, my Lord, will love me forever. From him no power of evil can sever. He gave his life to ransom my soul. Now I belong to him. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Not for the years of time alone, but for eternity.
Sing verse 3.
Joy floods my soul, for Jesus has saved me, freed me from sin that long had enslaved me. His precious blood he gave to redeem. Now I believe. to him. Now I belong to Jesus. Jesus belongs to me. Not for the years of time alone, but for eternity.
Thank you. You may be seated. Not for the years of time alone, but for all eternity. So just as you bought that old chair that was all broken down, dull finished, or that Model A Ford, and you worked hard on it and made it beautiful. God makes each one of us something beautiful by his power to his honor and glory.
Jesus makes beautiful things of my life. Carefully touching me, causing my eyes to see. Jesus makes beautiful things of my
time.
Beautiful, beautiful, Jesus is beautiful, and Jesus makes beautiful things of my life. Carefully touching me, causing my eyes to see. Jesus makes beautiful things of my life.
Is everybody feeling beautiful this morning? Absolutely. Beautiful is a great word. It describes the workmanship that God does in us. It also describes the name of his Son. Jesus, what a beautiful name.
Jesus,
what a
beautiful name. Son of God, Son of man, Lamb that was slain. Joy and peace, strength and hope, grace that blows all fear away. Jesus, what a beautiful name.
Let's sing that again.
Jesus,
what a
beautiful name. Son of God, Son of man, Lamb that was slain. Joy and peace, strength and hope, grace that blows all fear away. Jesus, what a beautiful name. Jesus, what a beautiful name. Truth revealed, my future sealed, healed my pain. Love him life and warmth. Grace that blows all fear away. Jesus, what a beautiful name. Jesus, what a beautiful name. Rescued my soul, my stronghold, lifts me from chains. Forgiveness, security, power, and love. Grace that blows all fear away. Jesus, what a beautiful name. Jesus, what a beautiful name. Son of God, Son of Man, Lamb that was slain. Joy and peace, strength and hope, grace that blows all fear away. Jesus, what a beautiful name. Joy and peace, strength and hope, grace that blows all fear away. Jesus, what a beautiful name.
Jesus, what a beautiful name. Let's rise again, and we're going to sing of his majesty.
Worship his majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom, authority, flow from his throne unto his own, his anthem ring. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship his majesty. Jesus who died, now glorify the of all kings. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship his majesty. Jesus who died, now glorify King of all kings. Jesus who died, now glorify King of all kings.
Thank you for that great singing. You may be seated.
Thank you. At this time, anyone in the nursery or VBS or youth group is excused. I don't know if there's anyone in here or not yet. But. Okay, we're about to go into our theme sermon, and the opening hymn for that will be number 454, Trust and Obey. Again, that's hymn number 454, Trust and Obey. And Brother Knapp will lead us in the singing. Yeah, technology's nice, but sometimes it's best to have the old solid backup. We'll now be led in prayer by Brother Henry Mitterick.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we are gathered together here so grateful for this day, grateful for the blessings that you have given us, grateful for all of your creation, Father, that we see around us, and we give you the glory. And Father, now we ask a special prayer upon this service, upon Brother John, who is to speak to us on our theme sermon, and we just pray that you be with him, that you be with us, that you bless us, bless him, as we hear a portion of your word. We give thee thanks, and especially, Father, we give you thanks for the Son that you have given us, that he is the ransom for our sins, that by believing in him, Father, we have all the promises that you have given us, the promise of eternal life with you. We thank you, and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
And now we're blessed to have with us Brother John Larson, who will be giving the theme sermon for this morning, and his talk will be on Isaiah 35.
Trust and Obey has been one of my favorite hymns for as long as I can remember. says, rejoice evermore. Is that even feasible? I mean, think about it. When we have sinned by eating the forbidden fruit, are we supposed to have joy about that? How about when Jesus was crucified on the cross at Calvary? Are we supposed to have joy about that? I wish those were trick questions, but they're not. Actually, they're very sincere, very heartfelt questions. Because the bottom line is, can there be joy about Adam sinning? Or can there be joy about Jesus dying? Those examples along with countless other examples. But let's focus on those two specific questions, Adam sinning, Jesus dying. Consider what joy was there in Adam's sinning. Surely God made it crystal clear to Adam when he said in Genesis 2:17, in the day that you eat of the fruit of the knowledge of the tree of good and evil, you will surely die. When I was a kid, this particular scripture, Genesis 2:17, this particular scripture really bothered me because obviously Adam did not die within 24 hours of eating that fruit. For me, at age 7, this cast doubt on the whole Bible. Because if God can't get a death sentence right, come on now. Adam lived for 930 years, and that's a lot more than 24 hours. It couldn't be right, and that meant that the Bible was full of baloney for me, a 7-year-old kid, a cocky 7-year-old kid. But thankfully, and I mean very thankfully, I was surrounded by a vast multitude of believers in Jesus, and I suspect that my favorite uncle detected that I had a major problem with the Bible. He didn't know what the problem was, but he knew I had a problem. And he asked me, my uncle asked me what the problem was. He was an elder, pretty old. I was a young kid. But he asked me what was my problem. And I had a super relationship with that particular uncle. Therefore, I wasn't shy at all about telling them what I thought and the way I felt about it. After explaining to him, my uncle smiled and he said to me, you know, there's a scripture that pretty much explains your problem. He had my undivided attention. And then he quoted my soon-to-be very good friend Peter, saying that a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. Let me tell you, it was like the parting of the Red Sea. And I walked through the sea dry shod. Because at age 7, I knew that the oldest guy in the whole Bible was Methuselah. And Methuselah lived 969 years, which is under 1,000. Suddenly, from that very moment, even until now, I have never, ever thought the Bible was full of baloney. No. The fact that Adam or any child of Adam has not lived over 1,000 years has come to mean to me, and this is me personally, but it has come to mean to me that I can trust the Bible. Now, equating 1,000 years a day to my trusting the Bible, that may sound irrational to you, but to me it makes perfect sense. As does the fact that Adam sinned. You know, the Bible specifically tells us why Eve ate the forbidden fruit. 1 Timothy 2:14. the woman was deceived. However, Adam knew what he was doing. Adam knew that he was committing suicide by eating that fruit. And he wasn't deceived about it at all. Because Adam wasn't tricked. Adam wasn't flim-flammed. Adam wasn't bamboozled. No, from the moment Adam ate the fruit, his love for Eve was greater than his love for God. At that moment when he ate the fruit, Adam chose to eat the fruit, and actions have consequences. Adam's action of eating that fruit had the consequence of death for all of Adam's children, even to this very day. So for our loving and merciful God, he provided a ransom for Adam, a propitiation for the sin of Adam and all his children. The equation is clearly explained in 1 Corinthians 15:22, where it says, as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Resurrection, it brings a tingle to my heart. And it also breaks my heart that so many, 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 many Christians have turned God's justice into just us. That's the way it is for many Christians. They'll tell you straight faced that Adam, that God himself was shocked and when Adam disobeyed. And he came up with this plan. He came up with this plan. His plan was because Adam sinned, well, now to be saved from the literal fires of eternal hell, you gotta believe. Well, I'm here to tell you, that's baloney. Peter sets the record straight in 1 Peter 1:19. My friend Peter says there that the blood of Christ was foreordained before the foundation of the world. In other words, God understood even before the foundation of the world that Jesus would be needed as a ransom for Adam and all his children. That's as it says in Romans 5:8. God commended his love for us that in while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So is it just us, just Christians? Oh no. Oh no. Absolutely not. Hebrews 2:9 clearly says, Jesus was made a little lower than the angels to suffer death, from now to be crowned with glory and honor, because by the grace of God, Jesus Christ tasted death for every child of Adam. This raises the question, could it have been anybody else? Couldn't I or anybody else die for Adam? The answer Abraham obeyed his voice. Abraham. God swears an oath upon himself because there is nothing higher. God swears that he will bless the seed of Abraham as the stars of the heaven and as the sand of the seashore. Indeed, all the families of the earth will be blessed. In Matthew 7:13-14, Jesus tells us of only two ways. There's only two ways we can go. One is the narrow way, which Jesus says, few will be to find it. The second way, Jesus calls the broad road, and it leads to destruction. And Jesus says, many go on that way. I believe that probably all of us in the room, along with many, many more, are walking what Jesus calls the narrow way that leadeth unto life. Normally, I would go on and on and on and on about that narrow way. The way where people wind up as the stars of the heaven. But not today. Not today. Today, I want to talk about the broad road leading to destruction, which Jesus says many are going. Therefore, are we to conclude that because most of humanity are walking the wide road leading to destruction, therefore they have no hope? No. No, no, no. Remember, God gave an oath-bound covenant to Abraham that he would bless all the families of the earth, as the stars of the heaven and as the sand of the sea. Am I pushing that enough? Okay, get that into your head. Stars of the heaven, sands of the sea. As we've quoted so many times before, when through Jesus, the ransomed of the Lord have returned to life, they will no longer be walking that broad highway leading to destruction. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They will be walking down a highway. Not a broad road leading to destruction, but they'll be walking down a highway which is called the way of holiness. A highway which even wayfaring fools shall not err therein. If you've done any preparation at all for this conference, then you surely know I'm quoting from Isaiah 35. Because Isaiah was one of God's holy prophets who, just as my friend Peter says in Acts 3:20-21, all the holy prophets have said since the world began that there will come the times of restitution of all things. Yes, there is a time for every purpose under heaven, as Paul explains in Galatians 4:4-5. Fullness of times had come, God sent forth his Son to redeem us as the adoption of sons. solitary place shall be glad, and the desert shall blossom as the rose, it shall blossom abundantly, and rejoice with joy and singing. And those from Lebanon and from Carmel and even from Sharon, wherever that is, will see the glory and excellency of God. What a day that would be. Okay, I've thought and prayed about this extensively. And I know it's a risk, but I'm going to take it anyways. How many of you have ever seen the movie Dr. Strange Love? There you go. As you no doubt recall from that movie, at the end of the movie, the world is being destroyed by a doomsday machine. But they're singing a song. I've always found it fascinating. And do you remember what the song being played as the world was destroyed? Anybody remember? We'll meet again. Don't go where. Don't go where. But I know we'll meet again some Sunday. My friends, that proves to me, and it should prove to anybody, that within us all, it's so obvious. Everyone, deep down in their soul, knows that this can't be all there is. That's the whole point of the song, We'll Meet Again. It's just plain nuts to believe that there is nothing else. But while others are looking for hope elsewhere, we know where our hope comes from. I'm supposed to have my Bible here, but I don't. I'm going to hold my Bible up. Word of God, that's where our hope comes from. Because yes, we will meet again. Those from Lebanon, those from Carmel, those from Sharon, wherever that is, and anyone, we're all going to meet again some sunny day. We'll all see then the glory and excellency of the one true God. The only Abba Father of us all. There'll be a time when, like Isaiah says, the desert shall blossom as the rose. Okay, you garden buffs. What do you need for great roses? What do you need? You need good water, good earth, good dirt.
Sunshine.
Yeah. You need good sunlight. Do deserts have a lot of sunlight?
Yes.
Yeah, they do have a lot of sunlight, but they have a very distinct lack of water. That's why it's a desert. If any desert is going to blossom as the rose, it's going to need water. Let's get down to verses 6 and 7 where it says, streams of water shall break out in the desert. Waters will break out throughout the wilderness. Parched ground will become a pool. Thirsty man shall have springs of water. And there's going to be grass. Grass all over the place. A lot of grass. There's going to be grass in the desert. Therefore, I personally strong and fear not. Behold, your God will come with a vengeance and recompense. God will come and save you all. Wow. It's so easy to worry about tomorrow. Fred, think about tomorrow. Things like all of these things come to pass. Isn't everybody singing the same tune kind of boring? My grandmother used to say that. My dad would be explaining to her about the kingdom. And my grandmother, on my dad's side, my grandmother would say, that sounds boring. even as a little kid, I said, what? But that's what she used to say. How about those who refuse to change? We can worry about that. Will wildlife sanctuaries be around? Will there be wildlife sanctuaries? I'm not sure. There's countless questions like that that could be seem to me to be a problem. But Isaiah 35:4 tells us to be strong and fear not. Not to worry about that stuff. Because your God is coming with vengeance and with recompense. I want you to define vengeance in your mind, and then I want you to define recompense in your mind. Because they're not exactly everyday words. Vengeance can mean punishment inflicted as retribution. However, it can also mean with great force or vehemence. Recompense means compensation. Frankly, it's something of value, like you're working to be compensated. You do work, they pay you. That's the way it works. Basically, it's something of value for something of value. And that's what Ransom of the Lord means. Jesus willingly gave up his earthly life as a ransom to be distinct emphasis on the narrow way, but not today. Today I want to emphasize those walking on the broad road leading to destruction. We're brought back in the kingdom to walk a highway of holiness, that even wavering fools shall not err therein.
We'll now have our closing hymn, which is number 646 in your hymnal, Redeemed.